coming up on Need to Know, his career, his accomplishments, and his shortfalls, in his own words. The tenure and resignation of Rochester Superintendent Bolgen Vargas just ahead. Also on the show, another election season is here and gone. But how do the results of this year's races translate to everyday life here in Monroe County? Some perspective on what it could mean for you. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know. Challenges can be turned into opportunities. That's a belief held by Rochester Superintendent Bolgen Vargas. When he officially took the helm as leader of the city school system, he certainly inherited a number of challenges. Poor graduation rates, gaps in special education services, burned bridges between his predecessor, Claude Brizard, and the teachers union and the school board, among a host of other things. His focus areas in tackling these issues included literacy and attendance initiatives, an extended school day, and a push for a longer school year, and other efforts. But after 4 years and 6 months shy of the end of his contract, Bolgen Vargas announced his resignation effective at the start of 2016. I sat down with the superintendent this week to discuss the highs and lows of his career at the district, and to learn why his challenges with the school board, in particular, were viewed as an early exit, as opposed to an opportunity to complete the work he had started. Take a look. You said in a previous WXXI interview that your mother would say the best gift she gave you was ensuring that you graduated from high school. It was a non-negotiable. So how did that influence you and your expectations in this position as superintendent of the city school district?
Well, that's the reason I'm here today, because of my mother and great teachers that supported me. And my dream would be that would be the goal in this community, that every child would graduate from high school and every family will emphasize education.
Your goal as interim superintendent was to build trust.
We're here basically to announce that the board will be entering into contract negotiations with Dr. Bolgen Vargas to name him as the permanent superintendent of Rochester Schools.
During the announcement in April 2012 that you would become the permanent superintendent of the city school district, Malik Evans, former board president, said you built bridges.
And if we're going to continue to move our district forward, it is important that we continue to build bridges and strengthen the bridges that we've started to build this last year. And we believe that with Dr. Bolgen Vargas at the helm, that will continue to happen, and he will allow us to see greater days ahead in the Rochester City School District.
Based on your decision to step down mid-year, would you say at all that that trust was compromised that you built with the district, with the board in particular, during your tenure?
I think people understand, and I've been here for 4 years. I've done my very best to make sure that our students have more art, more music, more sport, more extracurricular activity. They also understand that when I came here, we had 800 plus people being laid off. School without the resources that they need, and we have a long way to go, but we have done a lot. And I don't think it's a secret to anyone in this community that I do have significant differences with the position of the school board and around school governance and the role of the superintendent.
You said you had some differences. I guess, at what point do you feel as though that relationship began to falter?
Well, when you stop doing what you need to do to make sure that our students and our teacher have the support that they need every day. For example, I do believe that there's around 80 million dollars that we could shift to the school to support our students, our teachers, and our administrator. And that would require significant decision, and some which would be tough and political. And in order for me to do that, I would need significant support from the school board and from the entire community.
And that support from the school board is what you feel as though you did not have to push these significant measures?
Well, it's necessary in order for me to achieve what I believe need to be done in this community.
Malik Evans and you had a strong partnership. And I want to know if at all that transition from him being board president to Van White taking over leadership as president of the board at all impacted some of the goals and visions and the work that you wanted to do and have done within the district.
Let me just say that I don't think this is about one person. It's just about significant differences that we have about the role of the board versus the role of the superintendent. And, you know, reasonable people could disagree on around important things such as school governance.
There are some in this community who were disappointed to hear about your decision to resign at the end of this year, including Mayor Lovely Warren. She said that she thought it would serve as a disruption in the education of Rochester's kids. And I wanted to know, you said this to me before, and you said this in press conferences, challenges can be turned into opportunities. So why not the decision to stay for the remainder of the year, your contract?
Well, I care about the district, and I do believe that this is the best for the district to make an orderly transition. That had not been the case. When I came here, it was unexpected that my predecessor was leaving. I do think that now the board has time to find a suitable candidate for the district.
When you stepped into your role as interim and eventually permanent superintendent of the city school system, you said that the achievement gap could not be addressed in an effective way if we can overcome some specific challenges. And there were three specific things that you said the district needed to turn around. So you said they were doable, but they would also be difficult to do.
Any child who attends 95% of the time school.
Showing up.
It's the first thing that we need to do. We have thousands of kids daily. And mind you that these are not just high school kids. These are students at the elementary level that are not coming to school on a regular basis. We need to take charge of that and do whatever we need to do to make sure that we don't have too many of our kids missing school on a daily basis. We need to improve that. The other thing is once they show up, we need to help them and support them to make sure that they cooperate. Because we do have a significant discipline problem, and we are addressing that. We are putting some support in there. Third, but not least, is the effort. The student need to put some effort, not just in the school setting, but also outside the school.
We talked a lot. I've talked about the attendance initiative on Need to Know in the past. So we focused quite a bit on that at WXXI. I want to know, how do you feel with the results in terms of the other two issues, focus areas that were really important to you?
We have made significant progress. I mean, for too long in this community, we have been talking about poverty. And the question that we are asking ourselves, what can a district do to mitigate poverty? So when I started here, we were giving our students the least amount of instructional time. They were spending less time in school than children in the surrounding district. And we changed that sad reality. For example, in this community, we talk about race and poverty and structural inequality. The question is, what can a district do to mitigate poverty? And I do believe that by expanding the school day, by making our school more like middle-class school with social worker, with sport, with arts, with music, that we have set the stage for what I think is necessary for this district to achieve the result that we all are looking for. If you were to go to about 12 of our schools, you will find that we are giving our children three meals a day because we do know that many of our children do go we are eating a meal at least one day per month in this city. So we are proud, but there's a lot of work that needs to be done. And I do believe that we do have the resources. When I came to this district, we used to talk about what we lack, that we didn't have librarians, that we didn't have art or music or sport or books. This winter alone, we sent, this year alone, this past year, we did send 150,000 books. And we're asking families to build library at their home. But there's so much that need to be done. And I do believe that we have the resources, but it is quite a challenge for an individual like me who would like to work with my teachers, my administrator, and my community to make sure that we do what we can to create schools that could mitigate poverty. And we do know that children coming from poverty are able to learn. No one argue with that. The question is, what kind of support are we going to provide our children at the school level for them to succeed?
We can't do it alone. We need your help. We can't do it alone. We need your help. And that was a call to the community that you made on several occasions during your tenure. Do you feel as though the community stepped up to the plate, and maybe in ways that we don't really even hear about?
The Monroe County Department of Social Services, they are working so hard with the district to make sure that our children are in school each and every day. They have my utmost respect for the work that they have been doing as a department, along with the district, to support our families. And the public library is providing most summer program opportunities for our students. We do have a very generous community. However, my concern always has been that we need to always focus on the child. And to me, the most painful thing that I found here, which I knew, for quite some time, that it was unjust to give our students the least amount of instructional time, and that we were not going to make progress unless we eliminated that sad reality. And I do believe that we could have a great district if the school district resources and the community come together to address our student needs.
I want to know, how vital has that relationship been for you with Dr. Urbanski?
They supported me in a significant way in shifting resources from outside tutoring program into the classroom. And we have been able to do so much. The RTA have been my number one partner when it comes to bringing books during the summer to every home. They have helped me maintain an emphasis on reading that has been unprecedented.
Well, I could argue that in high schools, some children need less time because they're more quickly ready to fulfill all the requirements and should probably be allowed to take courses at the college level and so forth. So because not all children need additional time, I think it could be affordable to extend either the school day or the school year, but we want to do it in a targeted way. We don't want to spend scarce resources where they are not so much needed.
When it comes to the longer school days and the longer school year, how is that going right now? Because I know that the RTA has expressed some frustration in terms of teachers. Just recently they posted something on their website that said teachers were asked to do an extended school year without additional compensation. How is that playing out now? And is that something that you hope to come to some type of resolution on before you end your term on December 31st?
We do have, that's an area that we have made significant progress working with the RTA. my position has been that our students need more time, more support, and teacher who work extra hour, they would get extra pay, and they are getting extra pay for extra work.
Why is he saying then that they're spending more time but not getting additional compensation?
Well, let me just say that every profession, our teachers being in the forefront, spend more time than most people realize. And for that, I'm very appreciative. When asked to work extra time, we pay for the extra work.
You have served as superintendent during the phase-in of the Common Core standards. I have to ask about the Common Core. So some have said the standards are good, and there are others that have said city school systems and school systems in general have failed in terms of the implementation of the standards. And I want to know, how would you rate the Rochester City School District's implementation of the Common Core during your tenure?
Well, it has been a significant challenge, and one of the reasons is that everyone agreed with me. There were so many things going on. Some internally, for example, I had 35 schools either phasing in or phasing out, KA, grow up, you name it, and changing name of the school. Some people, my families didn't even know the names of some of our schools. So APPR, the new teacher evaluation, a new curriculum, new standards. And I think that, you know, how I designed this change, I would have done more gradually. So I think that the implementation of that be the teacher evaluation, the Common Core standards, new curriculum, new assessment, there's no question that we could have done much better. And it would have begun by having a well thought out plan in which you can execute. However, district like Rochester, had to respond to external forces, in this case, the federal government and the state. And I'm not blaming them, but there's no question in anyone's mind that this thing came fast to us when it came to the fact that I've been superintendent for 4 years. I had negotiated already 3 teacher evaluations. So this year we have one in place, the state legislature changing next year, and it's just, for lack of a better word, it's just crazy. That's not the way to implement something as important as a new curriculum, a new standard, or a new teacher evaluation.
I want to go into your legacy and when you reflect on it. And I know that you've mentioned longer school days. You've mentioned some of the partnerships that you've created as things that you're proud of. What are some other things that you maybe haven't shared that when you reflect on your legacy, you are proud of with the work that you've done in the district?
The conversation on children. I think the community attendance, for example, we all are talking about attendance. The budget, how we have shifted millions of dollars into the classroom and to support teachers. You mentioned expanded learning. We end the 50 years tradition of providing the Rochester students the least amount of instructional time. But at the end of the day, it's about our students and the kind of support. I would measure this community by how successful we are in helping our students graduate from high school and being ready for college, for a job, or the military. There's a lot of things that I would love to do, and one of them, the most important thing for me is to continue to work with issues related to children, and that is my hope.
Bolgen Vargas will serve as superintendent until December 31st. In the new year, he'll be an advisor to Dan Loengard, a former superintendent in Syracuse who has been serving as what's called an outside educational expert to the Rochester City School System for the past few years. Well, Cheryl Denoffel, Jack Moore, Tanya Conley, and Adam McFadden. These are some of the big wins from this year's general election in Monroe County. As Republicans pick up a new seat in the county legislature, incumbent Democrats maintain control of city council, and our new county executive continues the GOP's 20-year dominance in the county exec seat, what does it all mean for everyday living for area residents? Joining me for analysis and perspective on this week's election results is Professor Timothy Nealon, chair of the History and Political Science Department at Nazareth College. And it's great to have you back on the program.
Ah, thanks for having me back, Hélène.
So perhaps, you know, our off-year election was a bit overshadowed by the hype surrounding the candidates of the 2016
That's
presidential
true.
Race. But I read an article where you called this a subdued election year. So what would have made this election season more intense and more exciting locally?
Well, I think several things could have made it more intense locally. I really think that had Mayor Lovely Warren come in, weighed in on the issues and on the county executive race, I think we might have seen greater turnout in the city. Mayor Warren is both popular and powerful. She's accumulated a fairly good-sized political campaign war chest, which of course she could also give to other candidates to get out the vote and to bring people to the polls. And turnout in the city was about 22%, which was really low, historically low. And really, the issues that the county executive deal with are the issues that the city deals with. Questions of child care, questions of tax allocation, public transportation, jobs. These are all issues that the concern us all, and the mayor did stay out of this race, didn't endorse anyone, and I think that kept numbers low.
And to follow that, it's interesting because she said recently that she thought that the Democrats could have done better. She said that the Democratic leadership needs to regroup after low voter turnout, and she said she'd even sit down with local leaders and talk about how to move forward. So I'm curious, you know, are these results of the local election races, are they about Democratic leadership not doing enough to get voters to go to the polls? Could it be that the GOP had a strategy that was successful, or perhaps, you know, voters saw certain campaigns, they believed in what those candidates stood for, and they got out there.
Well, the people who voted believed
right,
in the campaigns,
right.
But that begs the question of the nearly 70% mm-hmm. of people who stayed home who are registered to vote in this county. Why didn't they come out? And there was actually a Green Party candidate who was very interesting and dynamic. Rajesh Barnabas really was a fascinating individual, and I think we'll see more of him, but they picked up 3% of the vote. I mean, Sandy Frankel did worse this time around than she did 4 years ago. She got about 41% of the vote versus it was like 44%. So the Green Party candidate did very well. I do think that there's several things at play. Obviously, we know that the Democratic Party locally is in trouble in the sense that the leadership resigned. They've had so many different leaders of their party lately. Romeo's doing a great job with what she has, but she doesn't have a lot of resources, and she has to deal with the fact that there are different centers of leadership within the Monroe County Democratic Party, which makes it very difficult to pull people together. I think what the mayor might think about doing is becoming the strong leader. I mean, it's not uncommon for the mayor of a large urban area to become both the mayor and the party leader, and there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, that could probably heal and pull people together, because that would also help county Democrats, who also lost, as you pointed out.
Right.
There is no race in which a Democrat and a Republican ran head-to-head that the Republicans did not win in this county. That's kind of shocking. Now, maybe the Republican strategy was not to run in the city. They did not run against the incumbent council members, which maybe kept turnout low as well. And Bill Reilich did say their new strategy was to be more coherent, and I think they also use social media very effectively. They didn't spend nearly as much money as they did in the last election cycle 4 years ago for local races, and I think it was very good at targeting those voters that would come out, which they did. And Republicans, yes, we can't take away from the Republican Party, but we should also look carefully at the Democratic Party.
Well, let's talk about the county executive race. This is probably the most prominent one this year locally.
Absolutely.
And I want to know, you know, what, if anything, is Cheryl Denoffel bringing to the table, bringing that really differentiates herself from the current administration?
Oh, absolutely. I think there's a lot of things. First of all, I think it's very interesting that when Cheryl was giving her her speech, her victory speech at the end, she didn't mention Maggie Brooks. Mm-hmm. I think that there is, that she is not part of the Brooks administration in any particular way. I think she's made it very clear that this is going to be a very ethical, that they're not going to have the kind of scandals, you know, the LDCs, Robitrod, these other issues that came up in the county under Maggie Brooks. I also think Cheryl has been very good about indicating where she's going to differentiate on policy. She was on WXXI, right. I think, last Friday on Evan Dawson's show, 1370 Connections. And she was, you know, talking about some of the things that she would do. She's definitely going to look at child care. She's going to create, you know, basically a floor so that people will get some services. We don't know the details on that. Right. But I also think she's also going to work more with the Democrats in the legislature and in the city. I think she's going to be a little more bipartisan because she comes in, if you will, clean. She wasn't as closely associated with the Brooks administration. So I think we're going to see some really interesting things happen within the first year. I expect very quickly she's going to come in January, and she's going to make some policy decisions that we're going to see bear fruit within 4 years when she's up for re-election.
And in terms of some of those policy decisions, are there any in particular that you think ultimately would immediately have an impact on our local community?
Well, I think the child care issue.
Number one, really, if you're
a working single parent or even a two parent and you can't get the subsidies, then having a job, in some cases, if you're making minimum wage, it doesn't make sense because it all goes to child care, which of course then diminishes your opportunity to then later on get, you know, raises or perhaps advance in a company. So you're making decisions that you have to as a parent. Well, I think that's going to immediately have an effect on some of our lowest income earners. And that, of course, will help everyone, since the more money they have, the more they'll spend in the county, which helps the county economy. And these are tiny little things that don't take a lot of money to fix, but I think DANOFA will fix those right away.
Timothy Nealon, thank you so much for your time and for providing some perspective, breaking out what this means and what could potentially, how it could play out in our community. I appreciate it. And that is it for this edition of Need to Know. I'm Hélène Biandudi Hofer. Thank you for joining me for tonight's program and throughout the weekend for those who tune in on Sundays. I'll see you next week right here on WXXI TV.